My first question concerns the word populism. What, in your opinion, justifies the assumption that there is such a thing as a phenomenon, potentially new political phenomenon, that we call populism? And why do you specifically choose this so charged and broad word, populism, to talk about it?
Well, my aim really is to re-signify the term populism. You know, the term is not that I thought, or I introduced it. The term is very much used at the moment. And particularly, it is used to disqualify many of the movement of the left that I'm interested in, the kind of, you know, new form of radical left, like Syriza, like Podemos, who I think are trying to defend a new kind of politics, which is very much a politics that corresponds to what I think left politics should be, to work for a radicalization of democracy, a different radicalization of democracy, and of course, and also to create the condition for what I call a hegemonistic democracy. The problem is that all parties or groups who are trying to break the post-political consensus to say we need alternative are automatically disqualified by the media. Those are populists. So it's a way to say we should not take their demands into account because this is populist, this is demagogy. So but my aim is that say no, we of course, one way could be to say, no, we are not populist. But I decided, and that's really an ethical-political decision, that it's better to re-signify the term of populism. You know, in the same way, for instance, the term gay was before used in a very critical way, but in fact, even the idea of democracy. Democracy in the 18th century was a term of abuse, it was not something positive, and it had been transformed. And I thought, well, in fact, the best strategy instead of saying, no, we are not populists, is to re-signify, yes, we are populists. We are populists because we defend democracy, and we defend democracy, we want to construct a people, we are left wing populists. So this is my strategy. And of course, there is not only that, but also I think it makes sense to follow that strategy today, precisely because of the fact that I think that the traditional frontier between left and right, first, it has become blurred, but secondly, and that was what I think today, I came to the conclusion that the way to re-establish a kind of agonistic debate was not by re-establishing exactly that frontier in terms of as it was established before. Because there is a possibility, given the effect of neoliberalism, the new form of financial capitalism, to create a wider chain of equivalence, to create a transversal collective way. And I think that the term populism is something which in fact is adequate to express this need for transversality. So this is why instead of, you know, trying to say no, we are not, and yeah, but because we defend the people who want to re-establish to re-equilibrate, as I said, the democratic part, and we are left populism because we want to construct a people that is going to contribute to the deepening of democracy.
Your book on the political, you're writing about demoralizing of political difference and the exclusion of the bad ones, the extremists, along moral lines. Considering the political situation we face right now in Austria, the new Austrian Chancellor, Christian Kern, answered in an interview about the cooperation with the FPÖ, Freedom Party, and about the criteria of cooperation with other parties that he's in favor of a catalogue of criteria, defining cooperating partners. And he answered criteria would be a confession to Europe and a definite exclusion of working together with parties who agitate against minorities or discriminate people because of their culture or religion or name. So as a conclusion, he ruled out working with the FPÖ in this interview. My question is, would you consider this as a moralizing act which constitutes an antagonistic conflict with the FPÖ, or does it demonstrate a plural, agonistic, democratic understanding?
But you say here that he did already say that he was not going to accept any collaboration, or did he say that he would only accept collaboration with the parties who would fulfill those conditions?
He said, I think...
it makes a big difference.
He accepted that the FPÖ does not fulfill this criteria.
Exactly. Yeah, okay. But so it's not a question of saying we are not going to... It's not something like the position that I was criticizing, I think not yesterday when I mentioned to the fact that I was really shocked when Philogène made the declaration that we should not even speak with the people who vote for the FPÖ. Like this is exactly what I think is the worst possible thing, because in a sense it would imply that those people are bad, they're intrinsically bad, and they can't be corrupted. No, I think that's definitely not the political way. So this, but to so not to take and in fact, you know, I don't agree with the idea of the cordon sanitaire. I think cordon sanitaire is not a good strategy because it means automatically we don't speak to you. No, I think that the strategists care to say, yeah, I mean, if you fulfill those conditions, yeah, why not? I mean, but of course, maybe, people suppose that you know that those conditions cannot be fulfilled, but it's clever to put it like that, I would say.
I think his last sentence was, but right now, if you could ask me right now, yeah. It's not fulfilled.
Ah, okay, you say that. Okay. Okay, but yeah, all right. But you see, this is not making some, is not taking a kind of moralistic style of rejection. He's making that in a political thing. Say, okay, in order to have that, we need to agree on those things. That's a political way of doing things. Because the other things, we can't, you know, with the party. That I think is the wrong way.
And where do you draw the line between the moral arguments and the political ones?
The argument in on the political, as I say, the before, like when you got your antagonistic, when there was a real clear difference between left and right, there you had a relation with adversary. People knew, you know, we got different projects. Accept that you have the other project to fight. So it is when you accept the legitimacy of the claim. But and the disappearance, that was what was I saying, the disappearance of this left and right distinction, which is presented as a progress for democracy, is not a progress for democracy, because in the field of politics, you can't not have a frontier. So if the frontier cannot be constructed in political terms, because the thing is that there is no more adverse political adversary, then the frontier is constructed in moral terms. Then, because the frontier does not appeal to people, you need, what is the stake there is, in order to create a us, we need to distinguish from a debt, so this is what the frontier is. And if the frontier is constructed in political terms, then you can have an agonistic debate, because you can say, okay, we defend that project. If you cannot construct the frontier in a political term, then you are almost, you know, obliged or led to construct it in moral terms, and then it's the bad words. And that, of course, is not good for democracy, because you cannot imagine having an agonistic debate with the people who are evil. Those people who are evil, you need to eradicate them, you know. So I think that the moralization of politics is something which is very bad for democracy. But in order to be that frontier is constructed like that, you need to have the possibility for another form of constructing the frontier. And this is why I think that the distinction left and right is important, and that's why, for instance, even when I speak of a populist construction, I want to make the distinction between right wing populism and left wing populism. So that, because they are different ways in which the people can be constructed.
I'd like to conclude with another trajectory of your work. Your notion of populism rests on an affirmation of conflict as a constitutive element of the political. Now, in today's world, with all the actual wars, economic, existential struggles taking place, why do you think such an emphasis of conflict versus, for instance, solidarity is important?
But you see, it's not, people believe that because I'm promoting conflict, conflict is dead, you know, and it's not that I'm not celebrating antagonism, I'm just saying this is a fact of life. If there is in our human society something which is called the political, it's because there is an element of conflict, of antagonism. And of course, not everybody will start from the same ontological premises. In fact, there is, and Oliver himself made this quite useful distinction, I think, between the associative conception of the political and the dissociative conception of the political. Then, I mean, some people start from an associative conception, and then of course they are going to derive, or say that in this case, the what is important for democracy is to try to find the procedure I have the consensus, but I start from another ontological premises, which is that no, the political is the dimension of conflict and antagonism. And of course, I will never try to prove that I'm right, and that, for instance, somebody like Habermas is wrong, because I think that at that level, ontological premises is something that you postulate, you know. And in that sense, I'm a post-conditionalist too. To use again a term of Oliver, because you can never give a final ground for it. It's a political political decision. This is a theoretical political decision. I think in the case of this, it's more theoretical political. No? You say, okay, this is where I stand. And this is why I think that we need to acknowledge this dimension. And see how we can nevertheless find a way to organize human coexistence. And then, of course, the dimension of solidarity is very important. On condition that you don't believe that you can arrive to a world that will be based only on solidarity and in which there will not be any more antagonism. You know, that for me will be wrong. But you can perfectly, and I think, in fact, agonistic things is there ways in which the question of agonism is to create some form of what I call a conflictual consensus. So there are form of consensus, so there are form of solidarity which are necessary, but on condition that it leaves room for the expression of dissensus. This is where I think, you know, because dissensus and antagonism is just part of our ontological condition, according to my view.
Thank you very much.